morning. My name is Edward John. I work at Ferndaleville IB World School and at home. Would you please raise your hand if you are first year teacher here? Second year? Third year? You've been teaching for more than 3 years? Raise your hand. Good. Thank you. Welcome to my class. And today, I'll share some of my successful strategies with all of you. So sometimes you can incorporate those strategies into your classroom. You don't have to follow me, actually. You can use those strategies into your own program. Yeah, please don't be afraid to not to follow me. Okay. Okay. Today's topic, I'm going to teach you how to bridge the gap between one and the society. So this is what I'm helping my students now, to help them to communicate with the world and help them to find out what they like through second language learning. Yep. So firstly, I'm going to thank all of my colleagues. They helped me to review all of the PowerPoint slides, and they gave me a lot of suggestions, comments, and some opinions to organize my PowerPoints. And feel free to ask me any questions you have any. So I'm gonna start my presentation right now. Yeah. Please think about this question first. How does education happen? I'll give you 1 minute. What is education? How education happens in your classroom? Education actually happening everywhere, anytime, anywhere. And education grows up or has this revolution followed by the time change, okay? From the very beginning, like last year to now, we have some education has been changed during this year. So this one is also education. So please take 3 minutes to organize your answers for these two questions. There are no right or wrong answers. Okay? First one, what are good characteristics of a school for you? And second question, what are good characteristics of a good class for you? Or a class for you? You can discuss a group and you can share your answer with your neighbors. Okay, let me start. Give you 2 minutes to go over your answers with anyone.
Yeah, they're studying, and everyone needs to be practicing.
It means to be a good characteristic. Okay. Now, second one. Wants to. Can you compare and contrast school, class, and the government?
And what?
The government body. Which one is bigger? The largest.
Government
is the largest one. School?
Smaller.
Class? Really, really micro view of the whole society. So everybody comes from different level, different families. There is a relation theory here. We call it critical thinking, critical pedagogy. So we use this theory to develop critical pedagogy. If you want to read the theory, you can Google that online. They'll give you a lot of ideas how to organize a critical classroom, critical education, and how to pose critical questions to your school or your students. Okay? Please do me a favor. Those are my students' model answers. So now please tell me what can you see. Tell me what is special, what can you see? Number four, what's going on with number four?
Yes.
Math is not good. Okay. Anything else? What can you see?
Figures.
Okay. So, at the first sight, which one have you seen? Once you see this group, 1, 2, 3, 4, which one you have seen most special? What's going on with these three? Are they special? Okay, now I'll tell you a very special strategy now. Very special strategy. Okay, now I want you to change your teaching style, right? You emphasize these three instead of this one. Okay, why? Because students, they need encouragement. They have to build up their confidence. If you emphasize this one most of the time, you are trained to be a person who is much more picky. Yeah, every time you are so picky for your students, you choose their mistakes. You try to modify their answers to be good. You try to oppress their abilities instead of encouraging them to develop themselves in your classroom. Yeah, we set our goals for our students most of the time, not themselves. So, in my class, in my language class, I encourage my students to design their own curriculum, design their topics, design their own scientific studies through second language education. But I don't really discuss their mistakes. I'll give them incumbents, like, okay, tell me what you're gonna do next time, how to make yourself better. Now we can see you've done something wrong here, and then give me some strategies. I even told my students to take 0 in their tests, not to get 100. Because I want them to write down each answers, to evaluate each answers, which one is right, which one is wrong. So I tell them, 0 is 100. Now, 100 doesn't mean 100, because you just get all of the answers are correct. But you don't know why you are wrong, why you've done something so wrong, and how to make yourself better. So I try to help my student to take 0. My school is really special. I don't know, because my students are very, you know, very naughty sometimes. They won't follow me. They don't follow me at all. When I was here, when I came to the USA and taught for my first year, nothing worked. Actually, I brought a lot of things from New Zealand, from my home country, and then I tried to organize a very perfect class, but I found I'm wrong. And no one wanted to follow, no one wanted to do something, so I started to communicate with my mentor, my school teachers, my principal, and try to find the best way. So gradually, I organized this PowerPoint for you to share all of my good or positive and successful strategies here. And now, so these are the so-called liberation in education. So we give students all of the possibilities, all of the chances to organize their own classroom, not according to what I know, not according to what I'm going to teach today. So I even told my students to organize a movie class to discuss which movie in Chinese they love, which movie in Spanish they love, which cartoon they love, which comics they love to watch. So they can discuss that and make that classroom really interesting and very, very helpful. And I'm not seeing myself as a facilitator. I see myself as a black spot teacher. If my students, they love this topic, I minister myself. I pull myself down a little bit and I use my language. Because pulling down ourselves is better and easy to help the students to get used to our language. At the very beginning, for the first class or first year's teacher's class, so I pull down my language, I use my students' language to talk to them. I feel what exactly they feel, like, okay, my school is in a poor area, my students, sometimes they didn't get breakfast well. So once my students, they came into my class, they asked me, teacher, I'm so starving today, I cannot focus on learning Chinese as a second language. So I prepared a piece of candy, cookie, or everything they can eat. I solved their physical needs first, then gradually dive them into the Chinese class. Yep. Please take 1 minute to discuss this theory. Do you agree or disagree? Now, could you please tell me, if you agree, raise your hand. If you disagree, raise your hand. Okay, there's no right or wrong answer. It depends on your evidence, how to support your own ideas. So I teach my Chinese language by using scientific way to help my students to research the world, to apply the real-world problems into their discussion, their classroom organization. I'm not just only teaching Chinese, so I also research my students' outcomes, achievements, and organizing my curriculum to fit what they need. So sometimes my classroom like out of, like out of control, noisy, eccentric way. We have a lot of research topics there. So students, they discuss at all times. I just stay away and monitoring them and give them suggestions. Yeah, I don't push my students too much. And I, according to their achievements, grades, I gradually give them assignments and different topics for further research or further readings. Okay. So now, in this PowerPoint, afterwards, we're going to discuss some elements in school and also in classroom. So far, do you have any questions? No, we are going to continue. This is what I've done in my classroom during the first class, first day. We've done a lot of self-introduction. Like I gave them a topic, like, okay, today we have a new student here. Like set up someone as a new student here. Then I gave them some time, like 5 to 10 minutes to prepare their self-introduction. And I set up the topics like, okay, which movie you like? And you have to share that with like 3 people around you, 5 people around you. Then let them introduce each other. Don't let them introduce themselves. So if you let them introduce themselves, it's not, there's no challenge there. So I give a lot of opportunities to my students to help them to introduce each other. So they'll crazily write down different people's information. They are around to each other in the classroom. Yeah. And next one, I help them to ask me questions. Not I ask them questions at all times. Because my students, they are crazy. I would say crazy. So I created a lot of complicated teaching methods. Teaching methodologies. I help my students to ask my question. I also ask them questions. So teachers are question poser, problem poser. You pose a lot of problems on the whiteboard or in their assignment. Help them to discover the actual problem in the world and then bring them to your classroom and for discussion. Yeah. So this one, set up. I help them to set up 3 questions to ask me. And we try to evaluate each question one by one. But not every single, like 2 questions, they are closed questions. Yes, no questions, they are not good to drag their ideas or to increase their creativity or imagination. So if you can, you can design a lot of E questions. Like if you wake up next day in somewhere else, then well, where it'll be? Make some questions like really motivate your students to think and create a new answer by their own selves. And for grading and assessment, we assess the evidence by which evidence that your students gave you. Okay? If they can give you a certain place, for example, like Rome in Chinese, or Italy in Chinese, or India in Chinese, so they get 100. I gave them A plus because they gave me a certain place. And the reason, if they can reason all of these questions, why they want to wake up in Rome, and then what reasons, 3 reasons they can support their ideas correctly, accurately, okay, they get 4 marks, like A plus. They cannot, I'll give their assignment back and then help them to restate, rewrite. And next one. Okay, on the next day, I'll pick up their common mistakes, and then we discuss these mistakes in classroom. So you try your best. Please try your best to drag your students and help your students to organize them, their discussion in their classroom, in their group, and help them to learn from each other. This one is, okay, in this one, I'll help you to evaluate your classroom environment. So Each single item in the classroom, you have to organize them in a certain place. For example, like hazardous environment, you put the wires where your students can touch it, that's not good. If you put your scissors in the place that students they can touch or get easily, that's not good. So please control the risks in your classroom properly by using a list to write it down, and then where you can store those wires or like electricity powers, the switch, you have to control your classroom and create your classroom a safer place for your students at all time. Do not let your students use sharpened pencil or bullet pen to harm each other. Yeah, I did have two students in Taiwan, and they harmed each other by using sharpened pencil. They pulled the pencil into their ear, and one pulled the pencil into the eye. I don't know why they do that. Something just happened. So sharpened pencils, bullet pens, they are really, really harmful. Yeah. I use this one to explain why my students they have to learn Chinese or learn Spanish or any other languages in the world. I try to use cognitive science like memory to enhance memory skills, like, okay, today you learn a second language like Chinese, your memory will be increased, the capacity of your memory will be increased. So I don't tell them to memorize all of the vocabularies, I try to help them to create the way to memorize the vocabularies, not just to, you know, like drilling, like, okay, every day I read it for 3 times, that's not good. Okay, today I'm gonna write it for 3 times, write Chinese character for 3 times, that's not good. I try to teach them, okay, you can use a picture combined with a similar pronunciation and the meaning to learn Chinese as a second language. So I start from borrowing phrases, borrowing words from English, okay, because those two sounds really, they are alike, okay. For example, like mango, in English, mango, we say mango to mean mango in English. In Chinese, we call it mango. Mango and mango, they are similar, so my students, they can easily copy these sounds or, or pronounce that accurately, so they don't have any questions or problems. So I increase their confidence at the first time. So like pizza, pizza in Chinese, pizza. Okay, 可乐, cola. Okay, cola in Chinese, 可乐. Coffee in Chinese, we call it 咖啡. So they are sound alike. And we started from this part, and I didn't directly go so deep in Chinese. I used these similar sounds to create my students' interests first. So this is the fMRI to show why we should learn a foreign language, okay? This one, only English speaker, monolingual. If you speak English, okay, this area, the small area shows you your brain. Your brain cortex is actively working here. Okay, if you are somewhere Chinese bilingual but you speak English, this area is larger than this area. Okay, and gradually, if you are Chinese bilingual, the areas here are gradually larger than the monolingual. So this is the psychological research to show why people are much more collaborative. You are a bilingualist, or you have mastered more than 2 languages. So this is the direct evidence. So I try to have my students to find the direct evidence, secondary evidence, or third evidence, and try to help them understand why learning second language is much more important. And this part is relevant to philosophy. Does anyone know? Raise your hand if you took psychology in your studies. Psychology? Social psychology or scientific psychology? All of them? Okay. So now, I'll use the most easiest way to help you understand the most top ideas. Okay? In the world, in the standard phase, okay, if we give students the test, like writing test, reading test, we usually have model answers, like yes or no, true or false, positive, negative, or right or wrong, sometimes like this one, or multiple choices, A, B, C, D. So those we are so-called standard-based questions. So according to the questions or the answers, students can be easily grouped into these two groups. But can any teacher tell me what is this area? What does this area mean? The area between right or wrong is wrong. No. I have students every time, they don't want to answer yes or no. They just write something else after the question. So that surprised me, and that's really interesting.
Yeah.
So I group them in here. That's really, really interesting. Try to find some students like that. They have great imagination, creativity. They have, you know, like extra skills you can learn from. And tell me what else. If the students, they are not in these three areas, what kind of students? If you give the answer sheet and then when the answer sheet came back all together, what kind of answer sheet will be? They are all blank. They don't know what to do. This is one kind of student. And another kind of student, they know everything but they don't want to do. Because yesterday or last night, they have something happened in their family, so today they don't want to take the test. Okay, they really, really don't want to take the test because they're, for example, like their parents, they fight each other. During the night, they are influenced by emotions, so those are the area where they have they feel hunger. They don't have energy to think. They don't have any idea. They didn't prepare good. So those are the students. So what are you gonna do for these students? And what are you going to do with these students? Those are critical issues here. And I call this one potential here. So I modify my tests. I modify my assessment rules. I just created a lot of assessment rules for my students, not one for each student, or one for all students. So sometimes you have to see the trees for forests. Sometimes you have to see the forest for the trees. And this one I also call it the potential. So I create multiple due dates for just one assignment. Because some students, they are good. They have good condition, physical condition now. They have good emotion now. They can finish their assignment really quickly. So they can, due day or the due time is really shorter than the others. And also at the same time, they can do much more assignments in your classroom. So feel free to adjust your due day or due time for your assignments. At the very beginning, in my first year, I didn't set up any assignments because it's really hard. It was really hard for my students to finish all of the assignments all together for Chinese language because we have five tones, we have Chinese characters to write, to practice, and a full sentence. That was mission impossible. So now, after 2 years, now I gradually developed a lot of assignments and different due dates and different rules for students, and I created a lot of words like candies, Chinese locking notes, or different Chinese souvenirs like dolls, or pictures, postcards. So once they get different grades, they can get different hints from me. And I try to relate Chinese studies to STEAM subjects. So once you include STEAM subjects into this area, everything's so crazy and also interesting. Yeah, me or not, you can try in your classroom if you bring your language and connect that to STEAM subjects. Like, okay, science studies, technology studies, economics, arts, and management. So if you can connect your own language, your Spanish language, or any other language into STEAM subjects, that creates a lot of opportunities in your classroom. This one I called the curriculum. Okay, this is the curriculum you can use to create your language. Connect your language to different subjects. Okay, you can set up a theme and use this theme to relate to science, family studies, English, music, history, design, technology, and also use your own language to math and physical education, geography, or drama. So please work really close with your school teachers and a lot of your colleagues. They can give you a lot of suggestions, opportunities, and you can set up a whole school-wide activities or studies there. And the next one, called interdisciplinary integrated curriculum. This one is much more smaller. It's not like that huge or broad like the previous one. This one, we just limit down like 4 subjects, or you can limit down to 2 subjects or 3 subjects. It depends on you. Okay, and you can discuss the thing, the concept, and you can bring the real world questions or problems into this discussion. The last one, you can set up just 1 subject area. For example, like Chinese or Spanish or French, then you create 1 thing to relate to different subjects. This is different. This is only in your classroom, not associated with different teachers' class. This one happens only in your classroom. So can you take 2 minutes to discuss what benefits will you get from these 3 curriculums? First one, it's school-wide. You connect all of the subjects from each teachers. And second one, you have limit down to 2, 3, or 4 classes from different teachers. This one happens just in your classroom. You may have 2 minutes to discuss it. Together, okay? Multidisciplinary school-wide curriculum, interdisciplinary curriculum between 3 or 4 subjects only. This one's happening in your classroom only. So, what are similarities?
You
got
to
pick
one subject. It's like government, school, class, multidisciplinary.
Good answer. Yeah, this one is school-wide. So this one is guided by this one, and this one also guided by this one. So, but you still can help each other for one purpose. It's all about memory. All about students' memories, because during my first year, my students, they forgot everything at the end of the year. And after summer, they forgot even more. So whatever I taught them, they forgot. We hypothesize this one. This scenario, okay? If We can use the school curriculum to guide just four curriculums and your own curriculum and connect all of these all together so you can track what your students have learned and help them to rehearse again. For example, like January. Okay, in January, we learned food. Okay, we learned food, the topic food in Chinese language. Okay, we say mango. For example, we learn mango in January. Okay, February. Okay, you can set up this one. Four subjects all together. Okay, you discuss mango. For four teachers, not only you, but also four teachers, and your students moved to different classrooms, and they reviewed mango, the topic mango again. So they can bring this knowledge to mango from my Chinese class, from your Spanish class, from French class. They go to this class, four classes, mango. This reinforce. Yeah, sorry. This process reinforce their memory skills. Okay. Next one, move to school wide. Okay, in March. Many teachers, okay, not only you, but also from different subjects. Science topic, mango science. Mango science. You know what I've done? I use mango to make a battery. Yeah, I use mango to make fruit battery. Lemon, I connected mango with lemon, with grapes, with cucumbers, such and such. All of the vegetables or all of the fruits in my class. Try to relate my Chinese studies to different subjects, like science topics or food nutrition, so I can guide my students from this one to this one, mango. Okay, this one I call it longitudinal studies, like from January, February, and March. So my students, they all remember mango effectively, and I help my school teachers to develop language program at the same time. So my school teachers, they also learn manguo means mango in Chinese. So I do not only help my students, but also I helped my school colleagues to learn Chinese so you can gradually extend your Chinese or Spanish or French or different language, world language program to involve a lot of school-wide program all together. Yeah, so this one, all of these three curriculums, they are all relevant to your memory and also students' memory, and you are good to track what your students have learned so far. If they made mistakes, you can come back and discuss that again or use different science topics like technology, like management or arts. You can help them to draw the shape of the mango and then review all of the phrases again. So this is my ESL teacher's lesson plan, or I got it from the internet. Yeah. And we all discussed the core classes here, and like learning community, learning objects, learning objectives, and the skills, the text. And I keep this one in my folder, and then I modify this one lesson plan into my Chinese lesson plan, or I use school-wide lesson plan. And on the back side, please write this down, it's very important for you. On the back side, I keep a classroom, I'll call it classroom diary. Like, okay, what I have to improve for today, what I've done good for today, and what are my students today? They have much more reaction to me. Much more feedback to me. I wrote all of this down. And on the second session, I wrote down what I can do better next and which part I can modify again. I use a camera for myself. So after school, I took 1 hour to review what I've said and what I've done in my classroom, and then I modified into my next speech in my classroom. So these techniques, my students, they are cooperative. If you have, if you use this strategy, you can limit down their like misbehavior or their teasing, shouting, or force playing in your classroom. Because I tell them, okay, I'm filming myself, but actually I'm filming them. They behave really bad. So this one helped me to control myself and also control my students. I told them, okay, now I'm filming you and I have to film my class. So also I can post this video onto school-wide open class, or you have your own website, like Spanish website, you create it by yourself, you can post your speech on your website. And you told your students, if you forgot anything, you can go back to the website and review my class. So you, this one also helping them to enhance their memory again. So later I'll show you, later I'll show you the website that I created online. So those strategies are second language strategies. Okay, we teach by situational language teaching, audio, lingualism, blah blah blah. Okay. Every language teachers will use those strategies, but how can we incorporate all of these into our classroom effectively or successfully? It depends on your own experience, not mine. Yeah, I do not just use one. I incorporate all of them sometimes, or I modify them into a transformative curriculum or strategy for myself, which I see the best for my students. Okay, you have to use all of these, or just one, or two, or three altogether, like this one. They like your curriculum. Or school-wide curriculum, small one, or the individual one. Yeah, you can have, you can set up this one. And this is the classroom management. I found it from Michigan State University. If you can take time to read this one, it's really, really helpful for your school and your classroom management. Because in this one, they talk about psychological management for your students, like how to feel, what your students exactly feel today, and do they prepare correctly or good or properly or worst for your class for today. There are a lot of questions to help you to think before you start your class. The assessment for my classroom is a flexible classroom. It's not really much more standardized, or it's not very essay type classroom. I used a lot of informal assessments, observation. I use observation to give the grades for my students' speech. Like, okay, you say vowels, you say consonants accurately, correctly, then you get your grade. And I observe their pronunciation of tones, like five tones in Chinese, the stress, the fluency in Chinese. Okay, you can keep record by those, by using those assessments. I use a lot of informal assessments. This doesn't mean you do not fit the requirements or the baseline in the formal assessment. I just decompose those baseline into the informal assessment to help my students gradually move up. Okay. I gave them some work samples. Like if they don't understand what to do or how I want them to do, I use work samples. Feel free to give them the work samples and help them to do that in a different way. And also I keep a portfolio of my students. I write down what they've done good at all times. I gave some suggestions, small suggestions for my students, telling them which part you can improve a lot. Like for example, like five tones, if you're pronounced wrongly in drop tone, and then tell me your strategies, like three strategies. Next time I want to see these strategies in your learning, okay, in my next class. So I gradually write down and keep a record. And I keep those records really, really stably because I use those records to evaluate my students' learning. And those are the organization you can join to develop your personal skills. And you can go to Actable if you are interested to traveling around in the USA. I think next meeting in Actable is in Tennessee. If you are interested in traveling around the USA, you can register yourself to Expo. And Flame, I got a lot of ideas from Flame and Expo in my last 2 years. And GCSNC professional development, like this one, you can share your own experience with the teachers here in Guilford County Schools. And also North Carolina, this one is really, really targeted for Chinese teachers only.
Yep.
And for Spanish, I think you have much, much more development opportunities. And for conclusion, in my classroom, I see myself as the agent of a problem poser. I do not see myself as a teacher only. I do not teach my students or impose what I think to my students. I help them to discover themselves. I call it scientific teaching, and I use scientific way or experimental ideas in education. And because in the future, reading, writing, and math, these three skills are very, very important for our students. Okay, not every skills, but reading, writing, and math skills are compulsory for our students. And topics, food, clothes, and transportation are the three revolution areas in the future for 21st century. Okay, for food, I discussed the food pollution, like our artificial flavors or the GSM, modified food. Is it good or bad? I help my students to discuss that in Chinese learning. Learning Chinese as a second language, I use them to help my students to discuss GSM, modified food. Okay, clothes. The clothes, what are new design of the clothes for the future? I help my students to read the comics and cut the comics down and bring the clothes to the classroom for discussion so we can learn the phrases for clothes in Chinese. And transportation, I help them to study the high-speed railway in China, or do we need a high-speed railway in the USA? I help them to discuss this one, and why or not, yes or no, and why. So, in my classroom, I reject a lot of banking theories in education. Banking theory means, okay, we teachers give students a lot of information and I want them to put it in their brain and memorize it, that's all. This is the old style of language teaching, but nowadays we do not encourage teachers or students to follow the banking theory. Okay, I strengthen their critical literacy. Critical literacy means how students, they decode the problems in the society around them, how they code those information into their brain, okay? How to read the question, how to answer the question properly according to their experience or according to their own abilities. And they are able to critique what they have read or what they have done in their classroom and make themselves better. And this one, critical translativity. This means, okay, your students is from the banking theory, transfer themselves into critical thinker. Okay, this process, we call it critical translativity. They have to actually apply critical thinking into their future study. So I call it transformative period or age for themselves. And critical consciousness. Once I say, okay, the sun rises from the east, is it true or false? True or false? Raise your hand. If you think the sun rises from the east, raise your hand. Okay, if you think the sun rises from the west, raise your hand. Yeah. Why the sun rises from the east? Can you give me a good answer? Okay, this one is the scientific methodology. Because according to our observation, every single day the sun rises from the east and not from the west. Every single day we see the sun rises from the east. So this is the natural rule. So once I ask my students why the sun rises from the east, they have to answer, okay, this is the common rule, the natural rule. So next one, please critique. USA dollars, $100 for a pair of shoes. Is it expensive or cheap? Yeah, you think that's experience that expensive, raise your hand. If you think that's cheap, raise your hand. Yeah, my students they have bipolar answers.
Yeah.
So they can discuss why. This one I call it critical consciousness. They have to give me their supportive evidence. Why they think that's cheap, why they think that's expensive. But if it's relevant to their social status at home, or their personal incomes, or their parents' supportive relationship there, and we can discuss the caring bridge between students, parents, and school teachers and admins here. So in your school, please be an active language teacher. You can help your school be much more stronger, be much more flexible for world language education, and you can help your colleagues to design and organize a better school environment. So this is the presentation for today. Do you have any questions? You can ask me some questions. Please do not follow what I've done so far, because in liberation education, we encourage people, teachers, to create your own way to modify your teaching style, your school environment, come up with your own ideas, imagination, creativity, to apply those theories into your own environment, and to find out the best way for your own students and your school and your students' parents. And please stay all together and please form a very strong network for learning in the future, not just for world language, but also for 21st century education. The problem solving, to be an active critical thinker, and please, please do not tell your students to critique a person. Yeah. They'll make them to be so picky. Yeah. Because once I ask my students what is a critical thinker, they always said, okay, I critique somebody's clothes, somebody's shoes, and what are those? And I said, no, that's not critical thinker. A critical thinker is much more like you critique the philosophy, like why the sun rises from the east and not the west. Okay, not critique the person, but critique the theory, the philosophy. Yep. So this is the way what I've done on teaching in my school so far. Yep. I think you can, if you think those are helpful, please share these ideas with your school teachers, colleagues, or your mentors. Everybody, you can discuss, you can critique whether these theories are good or bad, or these are effective or not very effective. So please be active and be a critical thinker first, and teach your students to be critical thinkers. Okay. Thank you, everybody. You've done a great job. Thank you. Next one, I think you have to go to your next session for discussion. Your home area or in your home school. Yeah. I have the sign sheet. I'll email to all the materials. Okay, thank you. Okay. If you have any further suggestions, comments, opinions, you can email me as well. So thank you for coming. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Have a good day. Thank you.